Hello everyone. Today we are going to have a lecture on Jyotish Shastra. We all know India has a very long ancient history. India has a rich heritage, India has a rich tradition, India also has a rich culture. Along with all these, India has a big tradition and knowledge bank. Many different shastras are developed in India. All are developed with the basis of Veda, world's very first literature is known as Veda. There are different shastras come along with Veda. Some are Jyotish Shastra, Ayurveda and all. Today we are going to have a discussion, a lecture on Jyotish Shastra. Our guest lecturer today is Gaurav Upadhyay. He has completed computer science from BITS Pilani. After that, he is working as a freelancer in blockchain technology. Gaurav Upadhyay has developed good habit on reading of different Sanskrit literature, different Shastra, different Veda, Upanishad and all. He is very keen to learn Jyotish Shastra, and he got some good command on Jyotish Shastra. Gaurav Upadhyay is now reading about all different Shastras, Upanishad, Veda. Now I request Gaurav Upadhyay to start his lecture.
Thank you, Devgiri unit of Vigyan Bharati, for giving me this opportunity, and Pushkarji for giving me such a warm introduction. So today, as Pushkarji said, we will be learning a bit about whatever I know. I will be sharing that with you all about Jyotish Shastra. I'll share my slides with you all. Yeah, thank you. So, as Pushkarji said, I'm a software engineer. So, as a computer science engineer, to be precise, talking to a machine requires precise sets of logic. When you talk with a machine must know what you are telling him to do. He can't guess it. Although there's artificial intelligence, but artificial intelligence basis is some sets of logic. So having such a background, I always look for logic wherever I went. I then, after my college, I prepared for UPSC, and then I had a introduction to Western philosophical thought, and I was impressed by their logical way of thinking. Because of my cultural background of being Indian, although I used to practice different kind of festivals and different kind of food habits, everything which was our rishis introduced to us, rishis made us for, but I rarely knew anything about them. So, as you can see, yoga and Vedanta at the third point. When I was preparing for competitive exam, I, like mentally and physically, I had nothing to do. So mentally, apart from whatever competitive exam preparation I was doing, so I thought of starting some activity, physical activity, which would give me some kind of relaxation. So I went around to check for a martial art class, but I didn't get one. Then there was a free yoga class happening near my home, and I started going there. After practicing yoga for some time, I found that it is like it has changed me mentally as well as physically. And what that yoga teacher was talking to me was better than what I was learning about Western philosophy. It was not just logic, but beyond logic. Being interested in that, I started reading Patanjali Yoga Sutra. And there is a second slok in Patanjali Yoga Sutra, that is Yoga Chitta Vritti Nirodha. Then I was astonished to see this this particular thought. Add that to the second thought, like second shloka of Patanjali Yoga Sutra. So then this grew interest in me. Then I started reading more about it, and then I came to know something about Vedanta. Vedanta is actually Upanishad, Gita, and Brahma Sutra combined together, and their interpretation is known as Vedanta. And I was awed by the thought process, the ideas. They were like, so if there is a water, you apply this, you will come to know it is H2O. These people are so scientific in their approach. So I was very impressed. I thought that now whatever Vedic is there, it is wonderful, it is scientific. Nothing is wrong about it. So the amount of faith, the Shraddha I developed for Vedic studies or Vedic values was tremendous. Now what happened, because I was doing reading and meeting with people who were following Vedic traditions, I met with Jyotishis, and then I came to know, like we all know, that these people predict future. This was my basic understanding. And because they were saying they were Vedic Jyotish, then obviously they was more like, I became fan of them. I went to them and I was like, these people predict future and these people take Veda as their root. So I talked about them that I am preparing for competitive exam, and they said very good things about me. And then that Jyotishi told me to have a puja done. So I did that puja, and that puja cost me a lot. Then just out of curiosity, I checked on other Jyotishi, and he said similar thing, almost similar thing. And I was like very happy. I was like, yeah, I already know future, but I have to do my karma. So I was preparing for UPSC, then I continued doing this. On the day of result, I met another Jyotishi in the morning, and he said whatever the previous Jyotishis have said. But at the night, I came, got my result, and it was totally opposite of what I've got. So I was very astonished and perplexed. How come something which is Vedic is wrong? Okay. So what happened? I thought there is something missing, because when I searched on Google, on YouTube, I saw that people are giving their own formulas, that I use this, I practice this, I do this, I don't do this. I was like, if in yoga, Yogi Patanjali is so much precise about what he want to say, how come these people are saying whatever they want to say? Okay, so I became curious, and then I started reading about it. So I started self-study on Jyotish. Okay, so I followed few Jyotish Acharyas, and then those Jyotish Acharyas were telling, read this book, read that book, how Jyotishis came into being. So they gave me some direction into Jyotish, and I started practicing Jyotish. I started learning about Jyotish. This Vedic Siksha page, Instagram, this is my page where I generally put Vedic stuff. So this slides will be also there on that page. So please don't write anything if any one of you is writing anything. Okay, so Pushkar, your next slide. So yes, so Veda. So Vedic Jyotishi is there, so we should at least know about what is Veda. Okay. Veda has come from a root word Vid, which means knowledge. It's probably the most ancient text of humanity. They say it is anadi. That means it has been there since time immemorial. But our rishis did sadhana, and in the state of samadhi, the knowledge they got. Okay, so this knowledge is called Veda. This understanding about the existence, about everything, who we are, is Veda. And from generation to generation, this was passed down through verbs or verbally, but later on people started to write it. I don't know exactly when they started to write it, but people generally say it is 1500 BC, but I doubt that figure. I doubt everything what Westerners have to say now, because it was heard in the state of samadhi. It is also not Shruti. It is not heard through our ears, but it was heard from senses of existence. Okay, so push the next slide. So Vedas are actually not one piece of instruction. Okay, they do not deal about one particular thing. They talk about almost everything which affects human life. Fine. So it's a huge text. Huge means very huge text, and people like they give for their whole life to study a part of that Veda. Okay. So there was a sage called Krishna Dwapayan. He was son of sage Parasara. So he knew that in Kali Yuga people are like their memory power will be less, and their people, most of the us will be cut off. So what he did, to for the at least those who are interested in Veda, he divided the Vedas into four parts on the basis of the subject they dealt, so that people would be interested to know about Veda. Okay. So there are four Vedas, as we all know. The first one is Rig Veda. Rig has come from root word Rig, which means hymns. Sukta, that is, so they have hymns about deities like Agni, Soma, Vayu, these deities. Okay, then the second one is Yajurveda. Yajurveda root word is Yajna. Yajna means rituals of rituals. At that moment, we'll say it ritual. In further slides, I will tell you what exactly Yaj is. And then there is Samaveda. Samaveda is nothing but how the hymns which were written in Rig Veda would be sung. Okay, so Rig Veda, Samaveda is Rig Veda, which is being sung. Then the last one is Atharvaveda. It is a very misconception that it has black magics in it. It has subjects which are earthly, as an Ayurveda, okay, economics, polity, so, and other things. Atharva has come from root word athar, which is permanent, which is not changing. So these earthly things which affect us, okay, so that we can connect with the final, the last, which is ultimate reality. Pushkarji, next slide. Okay, now, as like I told you that Krishna Dwapayan, who is popularly known as Veda Vyas because of his work, he divided Vedas into four parts. Now each Veda is also divided into four sections, four major sections. The first section is called Samhita. Samhitas have mantras, hymns, prayers, litanies and benedictions. Okay, actually it is karma, part of karma kand, rituals which a person is supposed to do. But like there are rituals, okay, so we are logic minded people. How would we know why we should, like, obvious question is that why these rituals are done. Okay, so people started to question that you are doing such ritual, why you are doing it. So pandits started to give some random answers, but as you know, rishis knew that why these things were done. So they wrote explanation about these rituals, these mantras, these hymns, these prayers. So those explanations are part of Brahman. It is, has nothing to do with the caste Brahman. It is the, it is actually caste Brahman is male in saying, this Brahman is neuter. Okay. So explanation about samhitas are contained in Brahman. Then there is third section, which is called Arankyas. Arankyas are actually what a person should do in Aranya. Aranya is forest, but basically it contains concluding part of Brahmins, like when you explain what these rituals and other things are there, so those things are contained in Brahman. Then the last and the most important part is Upanishad. Upanishad basically means come near me, I will destroy you. That means come near a guru, I will destroy you. Okay, so whatever is in the Vedas, first Samhita, where you actually practice things which we have to do, and then when you start the first thing of doing any, like when we were student, teachers told us to do this. Later on, we came to know what these things stood for, and then finally we understood why these things were there. So Upanishad actually is the part of Vedas which talks about the ultimate reality, our existence, who we are, and how we are connected with the Supreme Being. So these things are connected in the Upanishad. And before, I have already told you, Upanishads are one of the part of Vedanta, which had Upanishad, Bhagavad Gita, and Brahma Sutra. Okay. Next slide. Until now, I think most of you would have understood what I am talking, right? So there is Veda, and Veda is divided by Tej Ved Vyas, who is popularly known as Ved Vyas. His real name was Krishna Dwapara. He divided the content of the Veda according to its subject into four different parts: Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Athar Veda, and Sam Veda. And what these content, I have told you that. And then there is division of each Veda into four different parts: Samhita, Brahman, Arankya, and Upanishad. And what these contains, I've told you that the Samhita part contains mantras, japa, and all these things. Actually, things which you must practice. Okay. And then Brahman part contains explanation about these things. Fine. And then Arankya is the concluding part of Brahman, but because we are in the society where to live among the people in the society is very difficult to practice sadhana on the day-to-day basis. So after Brahman, we have Arankyas, and after Arankyas, Upanishad. Final, the summary of everything. Who we are, what is Atma, what is Brahma, what is everything, what is this life, what is afterlife, everything is contained in Upanishads. These are the topmost part of Vedas. Next slide. So we in general talked about what is there in Veda, okay, but what is the core philosophy of Veda? Before we understand Jyotish and why Jyotish came into existence, we have got some idea about Veda. Now we will know about what is Vedic thought. What is Vedic thought? So there are two important questions which every philosopher asks: who we are and what is this? What is this means? What is outside us? Okay. Different philosophers give different answer to this. But Veda is not philosophy. Veda is science. It is as simple as that there is water, and when you apply certain method, you come to know that water is H2O. Sulfuric acid, H2SO4. So in Vedic thought, they gave us methods which are there in Samhita and other things. And then you will automatically come to know who we are. But as an ignorant being, we do not know who we are. Fine. So the core of philosophy of Vedic thought is that we are Jeeva. We, for example, I am Gaurav. Okay. So as a Gaurav, I think I am this body. I am this eyes, mouth, ears, hands. I am this. Okay. But our Rishi said, no, you are not this. Because of ignorance, avidya, you think you are this. And due to this, you are living a life of misery, life of sorrow. If I tell you that if I cut my hand and put my hand here and my body is this side, I'll ask you, who am I? Is this hand or this my body? Few seconds back, I was this. And when I was small, I was Gaurav. And now I've become big, I'm Gaurav. So I've changed, billions of cells has grown and died within me, but I've still remained Gaurav. This is not mathematics. Two after billions of years will all remain two. How come I, who is always changing, can be something constant Gaurav? If somebody has seen me when I was small, and if somebody meets me now, he won't remember me. He will say, I don't know you. So we are giving state of exactness to something which is always changing. So something which is always changing, and you are telling this is the state of ignorance. Okay. So our Rishi said that is the state of ignorance, the life, that is Jeeva. Okay. So now, who we are, they said. So there cannot be a word to that thing, but because I have to communicate with somebody and tell them that this is this, so these people said you are Atma. Okay. When you say something, it gets some meaning. Okay. Everyone has different meaning nowadays. Today, Atma is soul, which is different biblical concept, but it has become soul. But Atma is a state of knowledge where you know who you are. This is the core of Vedic philosophy, from moving from avidya to vidya. Okay, so I'm living from unconscious life to a conscious life. But it is not so simple. As a human being, we have need. We have need to have food. We need to have a shelter. We need to have some job so that we can earn some money. So we have different requirements as a human being. And then we have to find out who we are. So not everybody is going to do that. Some people are in economics, some people are into some different part of their life. Some people, there are different people doing different things. And because of that, everyone is surviving. So rishis made a culture. That culture supported this moving from subconsciousness to consciousness. So Vedas have everything which is required to move a person from consciousness, unconsciousness to consciousness. अचेतना से चेतना की ओर जाने का रास्ता है वेद। तो वेदों को जब आप पढ़ेंगे तो इट डील्स विद सो मच टॉपिक्स, सो मेनी टॉपिक्स दैट इट इज नॉट पॉसिबल फॉर अ सिंगल पर्सन टू डू इट। एंड व्हाट हैपेंस व्हेन यू डू नॉट हैव अ सिंगल अथॉरिटी ऑन सम एवरीथिंग, एवरीबॉडी इज सेइंग एवरीथिंग अबाउट दैट थिंग, ओके, एंड यू डोंट नो व्हाट हु इज राइट, हु इज नॉट राइट। सो यू सी विद इन अवर ट्रेडिशन देयर आर डिफरेंट सेक्ट, पीपल आर फाइटिंग ऑन व्हाट मींस व्हाट, व्हाट मींस व्हाट। So Jyotish is a part of Veda, Vedanga. We'll know about it. So please, next slide. So this is the picture which is depicting that Lord Vishnu, Bhagwan Vishnu, is the ultimate reality in a symbolic form, exists in all beings. So I exist, then there is one organ in me. That organ is made up of some compounds, and compounds are ultimately made up of atom, atoms are made up of neutrons and protons or whatever. So ultimate Param Tattva is Vishnu, and that Param Tattva doesn't change. That Param Tattva remains the same. Okay, why we need to go? We need to go there because we live a life of sorrow, and then we need to go to the life of happiness. Some people would say, I am happy with that, so it is not for them. But you are part of our society. If you will remain in sorrow, you will do things which will affect based on absolute reality, that will also make you conscious. Asking question is not wrong. Saying I am unconscious is not wrong. Saying I am happy is not wrong. But then being open to things which we don't know and then moving towards consciousness is what Vedas help in. Vedas has polity, Vedas have governance, Vedas has systems to rule. Okay, Vedas contain almost everything. Ayurveda, medicine is there, Dhanurveda, the way to fight, they have Shilpa Shastra, the way that houses should be constructed, everything is there. Okay, so this picture represents that Lord Vishnu is there in every being. Okay, he is a material being which is always changing, it is his nature, attribute, and then he exists in the form of absolute reality in every being. Some say we are the part of Lord Vishnu and some say we are absolute Lord Vishnu, that is a different topic. The Vedas being interpreted in different ways. But this is, in short, what Vedas stand for and how Vedas were developed. So again, Vedas have four parts. Vedas is actually one. And Krishna Dwapara divided into four. Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sam Veda, Athar Veda, which again contains Samhita, Brahman, Arankya, Upanishad. And then the basic philosophy that we are Atma, but we considered ourselves as Jeeva. Because we consider ourselves as a Jeeva, we have sorrow, we have misery. We have to move from sorrow, misery to happiness. Dukha se sukha ki or jana is taught in a Veda. Okay, and we all are doing different stuff in our life. So rishis thought about this. They said, no, this should not be privilege of one particular person. Everyone has the right to become conscious. So Vedas deal with tremendous amount of things. Okay, tremendous amount of things which affect. You have to take just one. They say if you read Gayatri Mantra also, you will become enlightened. But to read Gayatri Mantra, to understand Gayatri Mantra, and to have a guru who will give you Diksha and Gayatri Mantra, you need to be privileged. Okay, so Veda said no, anybody who lives in the society will have system which help you to uplift your consciousness. Suppose if you want to read something, you cannot go and read in DJ. Okay, you need a peaceful environment to do this. So Vedas construct an environment. They talk about a society where this kind of system will exist so that you will move from unconscious to consciousness and you will know you who you are. Okay, so now as we talked about Vedas, what are Vedas and what they stand for, the most important thing everybody would have known that as a Vedic person you should perform yagya. What is yagya? You see these some people sitting around near a fire putting something inside some sense of sound. So this is popular image of a yagya. Okay, so people say we are as a like Vedic person who must perform certain yagya to live their life. So what is yagya? We'll know yagya before we come to actual our topic, Jyotish. Okay, so please next slide. So Vedas were divided into Brahman, Samhita, Arankya and Upanishad. The first two parts, Samhita and Brahman, are also known as Karma Kanda because they deal with what you should do and how you should do and what is the significance of doing that. Arankya and Upanishad are actually the philosophical part of Veda. They say when you do this, you become this. Okay, so yagya is a part of Karma Kanda. It is a ritual that every person should perform. Now, yagya popularly is seen, like I showed you in that image, that there are people doing yagya. So yagya is the most misunderstood thing in present time. Yagya is the activity which a person should do. Suppose if Brahmins are doing certain yagya, okay, and I who is a Kshatriya or a Shudra sitting outside and doing some yagya, no, not doing anything, how would it have, like, do good for me? A person doing yagya will benefit. I am not getting any benefit out of it. Okay, so yagya did not mean this. Yagya meant to keep the ultimate reality, Ishwara, in the center and performing your act. When you keep the ultimate reality at the center and perform your act, okay, this combines everything which is in Bhagavad Gita. This combines Karma Yoga, performing act without seeking for phala. This combines Jnana Yoga, how to perform your yoga. Okay, and then it combines bhakti also, because you are having full devotion in Ishvara. So this combines everything. So it yagya reminds us about our true nature to us. We have forgotten our true nature. And those who don't know, it gives them a path to know their true nature. Also, when a Brahmin does yagya, he is not doing yagya for himself. Or when a person is doing yagya, he is not doing yagya for himself. He is restoring the balance in the society. When you are living in the society, you are taking something from the society. Okay. Yagya is a process of giving back to the society. Doing, becoming a balance. So there is a concept of dana in Hindu dana. Why we do dana? We do dana because it tells about we are not important. We are as important as we think, we are not that important. Life doesn't revolve around us. We are just a small part of the nature, existence. If we exist, we don't exist, nothing changes. So by doing yagya, you recreate the space for everyone. It is the most, like you have a waste management system, right? So there's a waste bin which is created. It is a way of recycling the waste. So that again the harmony is balanced, but diversity remains. Now we have a problem like climate change is happening. Why it is happening? Because we all are greedy and we are exploiting every time. Our everything is centered around economy, our ideas, our life. There was a time when everything was centered around absolute reality. And that absolute reality which existed, which exists, to go back to that root so that everything exists around that reality, yagya is a medium. And the Veda talks about that. Now, if you talk with a small child, he will tell you what he has to become. He will tell you, become doctor, this. Then everyone in the house is earning, but still they are unhappy. Because what is happening, everyone is talking about economy, not about knowing themselves. They are living in the life of Jiva. Okay, Jiva can not become happy in this world life. This is the core of Vedas. So you must have, all must have heard that time, like, is very important to perform certain yoga. There are 1008 yoga. Basically, what it is saying that certain kind of activity should be performed in certain amount, certain time. This is very simple. For example, if you have to play cricket, you won't be you having full stomach food and then go to play cricket, right? Evolution happened. We became human being. We, most of our ancestors lived in morning, did work in the morning and slept at night. So there is a time for everything. Everything should be done at particular time. So 1008 yoga or activities combine everything which a person should perform. Okay, so what is the conception of time? Now, Albert Einstein gave a special relativity theory and said that space and time, okay, they're just coordinate, four-dimension coordinates. They're a block of memories which happen one after other. This is the modern definition of time. And this is most talked about time. But our Rishi said, time is a tattva. It is the potential of the Supreme Being to bring about change. It has its own quality. It has its own attributes. What does that mean? It means there are different planets, there are different galaxies, whatever, the whole existence is very big. Okay. Around Earth, there is Moon revolving, and Earth is revolving around Sun. Sun is revolving around another center, and that another center is revolving around some center. And this, there are infinite number of centers, and everything is happening on a regular day basis. Okay. There is a rhythm to this. For example, when we play guitar or piano or anything, you have certain notes. When you click them, there is some music coming out of it. So everywhere there is some kind of music happening. Then as the time changes, different kind of music are like they're important for different kind of activities. For example, if you are playing jazz, then you will do and dance. If you are doing Bharatanatyam, there is different time. So because everything exists in the universe, okay, they are creating a rhythm. If you meet a person who knows Jyotish, he will tell you that when you were born, you chose to be born at particular nakshatra. Because when you were in an egg and when you first came into, started to become a human being, that nakshatra, the rhythm which existed in the universe, has a sum, that image in your mind. And because you are unconsciousness, what happens in nature, if you see a bird, okay, that bird does activity one after other according to the changing nature around it. Similarly, an unconscious being having a image in his mind will do activity according to his nature one after other. So that is the brief introduction of time. Time itself is a very complex and vast topic. Okay, so I don't think I would be able to cover this, but this is a very brief introduction. We'll go to the next slide. Okay, so this is what I have told you, that what is time. Now, how this time should be calculated? So there is this whole existence and we have to perform our duties. Certain time is important for certain kind of activity. This was known to us, our rishis, in a state of consciousness. Now though, our intelligence have destroyed our relationship with the nature, and again we, through our intelligence, we have created instruments which are destroying our nature also. Okay, our rishis who are in touch with the existence, they knew certain amount of time, certain kind of techniques. They build certain kind of techniques so that we would know at what time we should perform our activities. So Jyotish Vidya is a Vedanga. They are part Vedanga means part. So they are the part of Veda, and they tell us how to read Vedas. They help us to understand time, when to perform certain kind of theory, certain kind of activity. You must have heard Muhurat. Jyotishi give you certain Muhurat. In that Muhurat, you do certain kind of activities, and in certain Muhurat, you don't do a certain kind of activity. So this is general nature and attribute of the nature when you perform certain kind of activity. So next slide. there are six Vedangs. I will give you a brief introduction to this. Siksha is phonetic pronunciation, how you should read it. How should you read Vedas? Okay, then there is Kalpa, which contains rituals. Then there is Vyakarana, like how different words will be connected. Nirupta, etymology, what is the origin of that word? Okay, when you are reading Veda. Then Chand, there are different Chand, when they are sung in a different way, they mean different thing. Then there is a Jyotish. Jyotish is probably the only Vedang which talks about mathematics. Okay, and it is said that Jyotish gave birth to mathematics. When Indians say ki India is the place where mathematicians were born, because of Jyotish, mathematics was born. And now we'll know what is Jyotish. So if Veda is a Purush, okay, it exists, it tells about ultimate reality. We see ultimate reality as Purush, and because it contains information about ultimate Purush, we call it Purush. Veda is a Purush, and that Jyotish is eyes. It is to see the outer space. Okay, literally Jyotish means the study of light. Here light just means tiny object which exists in the sky. When you see up what exists and how it is changing our life, that is Jyotish. Okay, and why do we study stars? We study stars to calculate time, we have come to know before also. Okay, so that time has attribute. So different attributes means different nature, and in different nature we have to perform certain kind of activity. Next slide. Okay, so somebody say, okay, why only visible things? Okay, so this contains, as a human being, just ask yourself, if there would be invisible thing, would you be able to perform your activities without a help of some other person, right? So it is a greatness of our Rishi is that they saw these changes and then they brought mathematics to us and whatnot, different things to us. And it is not that we knew only about some stars which were visible to us. They talk about non-visible planets also. They talk about Uranus, Neptune. They talk about different parallel universe exists. They talked about it. There is a famous story that once Brahmaji, so every universe has one Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. So when Brahmaji went to Krishna Bhagwan, and when he was in Dwar, he asked Dwarpal to tell Krishna Bhagwan, tell Brahma has come. So Krishna ji said, ask him which Brahma has come. Okay, so this guy came and he said, Dwarpal asked him, which Brahma are you? So he was shocked to know that there exist different Brahmas also. So Krishna Bhagwan called all the Brahmas. So there were 1,000-headed Brahma, 100-headed Brahma. Our Brahma has only 4 heads. So our universe is probably the smallest of all the universe. Okay, so Rishis knew about that only. But they made Jyotish for us to perform activities in certain times so that we will live a conscious life. Next slide. Now I'll come to this basic idea. So I'm saying that these stars change our nature, that space, nature of the space in which we live. So we are also part of our nature, right? We are also affected. I told you when I was born in certain nakshatra, that image is there in my mind. I am a part of nature. It changes my mind. So there is in a Rig Veda, there is a Nasadiya Sukta which talks about existence. So it says everything has come from one point and everything is same. Everything is a part of same thing. Okay. So suppose if my thumb is hurt, my leg also knows that my thumb is hurt. Okay. So it cannot be said that something is not related to something. Everything is universe is connected to something. If sun affects us, we affect sun also. But we don't come to know because we are not conscious. In Bhagavad Gita, shlok, chapter 15 shlok says, Mamesha Vansho Jiva Loke Jiva Bhuta Sanatana. The embodied souls in this material world are my eternal fragments part. Bhagavan Krishna says, everything is me. You are my part. It just means we are organically one. Therefore, changes in star affect us and we affect the change stars. This is in short. Now, I'll give you some recent studies which, like what our ancestors told, they are working on this. So there is something called cosmochemistry. It is study of the chemical composition of existence. Okay, and the hypothesis besides this, that everything in the universe is one. This is what Bhagavad Gita said. This is what Nasadiya Sutta and Bhagavad Veda said. There are ample of evidence. If you go and Google cosmochemistry, they will give you ample of evidence. They put hypothesis, then they experiment, then they give you evidence. Next slide. So there was this person called Alexander Kisevic. Okay, he was a Soviet scientist, and he did some amazing work. What he did, he told that whenever there is a change in sun, okay, after 11 years, there's a war happening on Earth. There's a revolution happening on Earth. There's something changing in the on Earth. He gave the example of Russia, that after every 11 years, this Earth is affected. There's a change happening on our Earth. But as you know, at that time in Russia, when he was there in 1897 to 1964, communists came in 1925, I think so, and then they continued till 1990s, but 1925 to 1951, there was Stalin didn't like it, because communists were like, revolution is the mother of change. And he's saying only when there is a change happening on the sun, then only revolution and war could happen. So he took that guy and kept him into jail. So this study he did it from 1500 before common era to 1500 before common era, and after every year he made an account of that too, particularly of Russia, that there is a change happening on sun and it is affecting us. And if you know that lunatics means pagal jo logo ko hota hai, pagal mentally jo changes aate hain, so whenever there is a full moon on Purnima, there are statistically it is said that there are more number of lunatics in the world than otherwise. On an Amavasya, there are less number of lunatics. So changes in sun and changes in moon affects life on Earth. And when you talk about Vedic Jyotish has three prime things: sun, moon, then nakshatra. Nakshatra is constellations. They are the reference frame. If you see from Earth, you need a reference frame, the reference frame. So when the position of sun and changes, they calculate certain time to perform certain auspices, activities on Earth. They do not talk about grahas in Vedas. Graha is later, where Parashara, Jamini, Bhrigu, okay, in recent time KP, these people talk about grahas. Vedic Jyotish don't talk about grahas. Vedic Jyotish talk mostly about sun, moon and nakshatras. Okay. So Veda, now where in Rig Veda this thing is, so there was a sage called Lagadacharya. He was a great Jyotish. He wrote a book called Vedanga Jyotish. So there were certain hymns in Rig Veda, certain Yajur Veda. He took it from there and then he combined them. So he wrote a book called Vedanga Jyotish. There is Arka Jyotisham, which is related with Rig Veda, and Yajush Jyotisham, which is Yajur Veda. There is later on Arkan Jyotish also exists, which is derived from Athar Veda. So he actually took all these things and then compiled a book called Vedanga Jyotish. This book talks about at what muhurat what activity should be done. Okay, this book primarily talks about calculating muhurats and activity to be performed. And then the question comes, now okay, so he's talking about muhurat, but how to know about different positions which of stars and how they are changing and all this? So now next slide. There's a person called David Pingree, and he wrote a book called Senses of Exact Sciences in Sanskrit. He said in 1973, 1 lakh books or manuscript existed for Jyotish Shastra. So there were ample evidence which existed, how to calculate and what not to calculate and what to calculate. But Lagnacharya talked especially about calculating more. Okay. And because there are 1 lakh book, we are not going to talk about 1 lakh book. The most important one is Surya Siddhanta, which talks about calculating the position of the stars and everything. We'll talk about that. So Surya Siddhanta is a text on astronomy and timekeeping. it has very poetic way of the way it is in written. So if you go to Surya Siddhant, you won't understand it, because the language of it is very tough. And second, it talks about complex mathematical ideas. So you should know those complex mathematical ideas so that you would be able to know this. Okay, so because it's not able to understand and it talk about complex mathematical ideas, it is meant to misinterpretation. Okay, and different people have come up about different things. So I'm not going to go deep into Surya Siddhant. Little bit you should know. Next slide. So there are 14 chapters in Surya Siddhant, and different chapters deal with different kind of topics, like mean motion of planets, the gatis with which planets are moving, and location of the planet where they exist. Okay, so it all Surya Siddhant also defines time. One is continuous and second is endless. And where continuous time, where all things are born and destroyed. Then it has two units, more than amurta unit. So first there is a book, it has different chapters, and each chapters they talk about different topics. And then he first gives units. For example, when you have to start studying mechanics and physics, you should know what is kilometer, meter, vector, and all these things. So this book first talks about units, and then he goes on talking about different topics in astronomy. Then he has proper table of trigonometry. He has proper table of different sine, cos, theta, these things existed. He has like description about instrument through which calculations were done, and these existed in our temples, mandirs, in our scriptures, and guru such parampara. Okay, now our temples were destroyed, so we don't have those instruments through which they calculated it. Okay, scriptures were destroyed too, and guru shishya parampara, some exist, some doesn't exist. So very few information about Surya Siddhanta exists now. So what it says and how it calculated and how it matches with the modern time, we will show that. It talks about Truti, and Truti is 1 upon 333,750. That is 29.6296 microsecond. It is change in the atomic motion of the substance. See, this, if to know change in something, you should know a thing which is smaller in size than that substance. So they had something which they could able to calculate difference in the atomic values. Then there's Murta, that is prana. Prana is breathing, some people say. So to have one breath, somebody took 4 seconds. So this was basic unit. There were 6 prana, 24 seconds. Okay, then nakshatra, hotra. Hotra means morning and night. 60 ghat, that had 60 ghatikas, and that was one sidereal day. Please go to the next slide. So these are the values calculated by Surya Siddhant, and these are modern values. So you can see they calculated circulation of moon around Earth 27.3322 days, and modern value is 27.32166 days. Okay, so these are different values. I will give you the slide, you can check it out later. So please go to the next slide. Again, Mangal Grah, the amount of time it takes to move around Sun, and what we have actually calculated in modern times. Then Budh, Brihaspati, Shukra. These are the values which exist in Surya Siddhant, and they are very precise to what exists in modern times. Next slide. Okay, so we have come to our last part, which is Panchang. So there were yagya which need to be performed at certain time, Muhurat, and then there were ways of calculating that was given in different books, important in the Surya Siddhant. And now how this time should be kept, so that everybody know. Now you have a clock on the wall, right? So when it moves, you know, this time is this hour, this time, minute, this second. So similarly, at that time, there existed something called Panchang. Panchang means which has made up of 5 components. What are these 5 components? Tithi, Nakshatra, Yoga, Karan, and Var. Tithi is lunar cyclic. One cycle, 12 degree motion of moon from sun. Simple. Nakshatra is constellation. There are 27 constellations which are reference frame. Okay, and each nakshatra, to move from one nakshatra to another, it is 13 degree 20 minutes. Then there is yoga. Yoga is conjunction and different kind of like sun motion, apparent motion of sun and apparent motion of moon combined together. There are different yogas you get, there are 27 yogas you get. Then there is Karan, Hathiti is divided into two parts. Okay, so there are total, so 11 Karanas, 7 are moving, 4 are stationary, 6 are among moving or auspices, and last 5 are in auspices. And then there is war, one cycle of sun, no, from sunrise to sunset. So sunrise to next day sunrise, this is one war. So these were the basic thing which they used to create Muhurat. So this is Pancham. Okay, so I'm probably done now. Last slide. So this is my page, Vedic Siksha. So there I will put up, this is my Instagram page where I will put up all these slides in Google Drive in the bio. So if you want to have, you can have it from there, or if you have any question, you can ask me now. Thank you. I think everybody has understood everything. So otherwise also, if you have any doubt, you can come to this page, Vedic Siksha, which I am very active on that. You can ping me and I can explain that to you. Okay. So notes will also be available on the bio of that page. Fine. So no doubt, I think presentation is done and we are precise on our time. Thank you.